It's really, really good to see you guys. Great to worship with you. And hey, to those of you that are joining us online, always great to worship with you as well. Whether you're there online because you're sick today, or need to play it extra safe these days, or you're traveling, or you're our guest this morning, or you're stationed overseas. We know that we've got some of you there as well. A lot of reasons to be joining us online. We would just say we would love to see you in person as soon as that's possible for you. But we are so honored that you would join us there online today. Great to see you guys. Great to see you all as well. And wherever you're at, would you join me in Luke chapter 15 today? Luke chapter 15, one last time this morning. We're wrapping up a series. We've been in Luke 15 for the last several weeks, looking at probably the most famous story Jesus ever told, the story of the prodigal son. We've been looking at these movements or awakenings or moments that people who find their way back to God tend to have in common by looking at the story of this young man who follows his cravings a long, long way away from his longings. He wakes up, realizes the pigs are eating better than him, filled with regret, wanting to return home, but not sure what would be waiting for him when he got there. Starts the long way back and finds that his father has been scanning the horizon every single day, looking for him, waiting for him, searching for him. And before the rock throwers or the shunners can get to him, the father finds him on the horizon. He throws his best coat over his filthy son. Gives him sandals and access to his account. The father's love welcomes him back home. That's where we pick up the story today. As we pick it up, I want to ask you a question today. And really, if you've got paper or a phone that you can do now, I just want you to jot down your answer, just your first gut first gut reaction to the question that I'm going to ask you in a second. You're not going to turn it in or show it to anybody else, but I just want you to think about it and sort of commit to it along the way, okay? So here's the question I want you to respond to. First gut reaction to this question. What does it look like when a person is good with God? How does it show up? What do you see? What do you expect to see? What do you expect to experience from the outside looking in as you're looking at a person who's found their way back home? A person that's spiritually home, or a person who's finding themselves good with God. When a person finds themselves good with God, how does that show up? Are you got an answer? Everybody got an answer in your head? All right, pencils down, let's check our work a little bit together, okay? How many of you, and remember, this is a great place, no perfect people allowed here, okay, no shame, let's go loud and proud with our answers. How many of us, the word that we wrote down, the thought that we thought, when it came to what it looks like for a person that's good with God, had something to do with their behavior, something that they do, something that they promise not to do? Hot hands loud and proud, let's go for it, okay? Yeah, there we go. Something they do or promise not to do, just keep your hands up, I'm going to get you some company. Some of you, some way that we behave, all right? How about a stand that we take? Some kind of a moral principle stand. Some of you join them. Everybody has hands still up. You're a behavior person. You're a moral stand person. How about a comparison to people? Something that we expect or experience that maybe other people of other religions or other faiths or other places on their journey shouldn't expect to experience in their life. Some behaviors, some stands that we take, some comparison. How many of you wrote one of those things, but you didn't want to put your hand up early in the process because you didn't think, like, you wanted to get called on? And how many of you assume that because the preacher's asking the question, it's a trick question, so you're not putting your hand up for nothing today? Yeah, I know what's going on. Okay, hands down. Here's the question. How many of you wrote some version of celebration? Party, dancing, loud music. When a person is good with God, what do you expect to experience? Look back at Jesus' story. I hope by now you've found Luke chapter 15. We follow this younger brother. He's followed his dreams and lived his worst nightmare and finally found his way home. So this is Jesus' metaphor, understand this, for a person that finds their way back to God from a long way away, right? You notice how he describes the response of the father and the scene the moment. Look down at verse 22 in Jesus' story. The father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it." Okay, literally that Greek word is the grain-fed calf. So we're not talking any of that grass-fed garbage here. We're throwing a real party with real beef for real people. Throw it on the smoker, get the Traeger ready to go. show. We're going to do the whole cow, and we're bringing everybody to the party, right? He says, let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead, was alive again, was lost, and is found. So they began to celebrate. I love that it says they began to celebrate. Don't you? It doesn't just say they celebrated. It's like Jesus, as he's telling this story, is really, really intentional about the scene that he's painting and the line that he's drawing. It's like one of those lines that we used to draw in middle school math, right? That has a beginning point, a beginning, and then an arrow on the other end of the point, and right there, that whole arrow is labeled celebration. He says they began to celebrate. So notice what that is. Okay, don't rush past that. The story that Jesus is telling. That's the image that Jesus chooses to use as he describes the life of a person who's found his way back to God. Life restored. Family. Father. And it's a parable of the story. It's an image that Jesus is using. But it's the image that Jesus is choosing to describe God's design for life. Specifically to the life of a person who finds their way back to Him, that they would gather together with other people who have in their own way been the beneficiaries of the Father's generosity, and together they would begin to celebrate. Why is that not the image that immediately comes to mind for most of us when we think of a life? Does that not feel like our experience? We relate to the younger son's journey, his longings, his regrets, his rescue, his return. Why does it feel like when it comes to the celebration, we're on the outside of the party with him? Even if we're aware of the party even happening at all. For us, we tend to describe life as a positive life experience we own. A lot more by how we behave, how we stand, and even how we stack up against everybody else. What gives when it comes to the celebration? Well, keep reading. There's another character in Jesus' story that Jesus wants you to meet. And it turns out his story might feel a bit familiar to you. Keep reading. Beginning in verse 25. Because meanwhile, that's an important word. The elder son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of his servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother's come, he replied, and your father's killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. You never even gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you killed a fattened calf for him. Most of the time, when we think about Jesus' famous story, we only give our attention to the first son, right? The prodigal son, the young lost son. But there are two lost sons in the story, aren't there? There's a rebellious son who's lost. There's a religious son who's lost. If you back up and look at the whole chapter, you can realize it's actually the religious son who's Jesus' main point in the story. Jesus is telling this parable in the two parables before it in order to answer a question that was raised by the religious elite who were watching what he was doing. They couldn't figure out why he would hang out at dinner parties with people that were spiritually sick. The kind of people that they would stay at safe social distance from all the time. And yet Jesus finds his way into those parties all the time. And Jesus tells these three stories to make a point to them that, come on, we've all become incredibly well acquainted with over the last year or year and a half. And this, the worst kind of sick, the most dangerous kind of sick is to be sick with something that you don't see the symptoms of. Right? And if you can't see symptoms, recognize them when they show up in you. It can stop you from getting help for the sickness while the sickness continues to get worse. And worse, you can spread the sickness around. Jesus is telling this story that you can come before it to religious people who were terminally sick and didn't recognize the symptoms. Trying to help them see it so that he could make them whole. That's important. And maybe where some of us find ourselves this morning. Our confidence in our own goodness may be the thing that's keeping us from God altogether. Because we can use our goodness to mask the symptoms of a sickness that turns out is the exact same soul sickness that the younger son had away with. And Jesus wants to make sure that we see it, so that it doesn't happen to us. That's one group of people that's possibly here this morning. I also think there's a group of us, maybe even most of us today, who aren't going to find ourselves eternally off the mark like the Pharisees did. We've trusted Christ, we're going to heaven when we die, but we're in danger of spending our whole Christian life on the outside of the celebration looking in. The older son can help us identify those symptoms, do something about it, so we don't miss out on the life. We pick up the story. The older son in verse 25. I told you it's an important word. It's the word meanwhile. We got to ask the question, meanwhile what? Well, what comes right before that in the story? Meanwhile, right in the middle of the celebration, the party is happening. The celebration has begun. Meanwhile, the older son's in the field. He comes back from working the field, and you notice the passage, it says he can hear the party before he sees it. In fact, I love that it says he heard music and dancing. How did he hear dancing? It tells you a little about the hype level of the celebration they were having, doesn't it? We're not talking about little sweet Victorian up on your tiptoes, prim and proper, tiptoeing around on a dinner party during the waltz, like down in happy kind of dancing, are we? This is the kind of dancing and celebration you can hear. Notice something, verse 26, the son hears the music, he hears the dancing. So he calls one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Isn't that fascinating? This is the son who stayed home. This is the son who stayed here. This is the well-behaved son. This is the good son. Notice what you have? The older son is in the same place as the father. Even working hard for the father. With absolutely zero connection to what the father has been doing. For weeks, you know the story. Months, perhaps even years. Every day the father's been scanning the horizon, seeking and saving what's lost. Thinking, maybe this is going to be the day. Remember, son will come home. The older brother isn't even looking. He's not searching. He doesn't appear to have been hoping or invested in any way in his father's pursuit. To the point, the prodigal returns home. The son who stayed home has absolutely no idea that he's there. So he's on the outside of a party. Some of us, whose default it was to describe a life that's good with God primarily through how we behave. Pay attention to what you see in this older son. What you see moral activity with mission apathy. You see moral activity, but you see mission apathy. He is totally engaged in doing stuff for the Father every day. But as far as we can tell, He's not engaged at all in what the Father is doing every day. That's a problem. And that happened to us. She said that happened to us. I told that story before. A little less than 15 years ago, here at Doxology, we took a spiritual health survey. 40 questions we asked, and everybody participated. We pushed pause on the 11 service, and everybody did it. And we just asked several questions, and we responded to them strongly disagreed to strongly agree to 40 different questions, just to kind of take our spiritual temperature as a church back then. That was a different day, but here's what we found. True story. The number one highest rated question, somewhere north of 85% of the people that were present on that day said that I strongly agree to that was the answer to this question. I feel prepared to have significant spiritual conversations with people who are far from God. That was a question. North of 85% of the people that were sitting here 50 years ago said, that's me. I strongly agree with that statement. That was number one. Number 40. Less than 12% said, I agree or strongly agree with this. Said, in the last year, I had significant spiritual conversations. Jesus said, I have come to seek and save what's lost. And some of us are like, well, good for you, Jesus. I'll just be over here keeping the rules for you. And doing my daily quiet time, signing up for extra Bible studies, write my checks, even myself, even the rules. Good luck with your search and investigation. Don't misunderstand, nothing wrong with having a daily quiet time. Reading your Bible, nothing wrong with the Bible studies. For heaven's sake, nothing wrong with writing big checks. You can disconnect yourself from the Father's mission and simply be a well-behaved, real person. And find yourself a long way away from God's intention. Life can be true up for you. But that seems to be a big part of Jesus being with the Pharisees, isn't it? They knew all the answers to all the Bible trivia questions. They knew all of the content. They consumed as much of it as they could. They gave lots of money. They even tithed off their spice rack. They didn't care about the people that those same scriptures over and over and over and over and over to the Father was seeking. That he sent them to be a light to show and to tell who he is and what he's like wherever he sends them, in their neighborhoods, to the nations, from chapter one of the Bible. Memorized it, learned it, and studied it. That's why we do all that black out every 2 months. Get to know the names and the needs of the people near us. Here's why we ask all of our community groups, we beg them to ask the blessed question every single time we're together. Because we don't ever want moral activity to substitute mission. Moral activity to exist alone, apart from some kind of engagement, what the Father's doing, who is seeking, who is loving, and ready to welcome every single day. You see, I'm really practical with you. We've been around Doxology in the past, we've done baptisms. You ever notice we always sing louder, longer, right after the baptism? Talk about a party. That's a huge celebration. And I promise you, the people that are closest to the baptisms are always celebrating the biggest. Because all of us are on the search and rescue mission with Jesus, every single week, multiple times, every single service, we get to have that kind of time. And looking around as we're doing it, realizing all of the faces of the stories that we've seen before, the stories that we know, the people that he's pursued before, all of us recipients of the grace of Jesus who have found our way back to God through his grace. The party begins. It keeps on going. Symptom. Look at the second one. Look at verse 28. Remember, Jesus telling the story of the religious people, the rule keepers. The older son realizes the younger son's come home. Look at his response. Verse 28. The older son became angry and refused to go in. And so finally, the Pharisees have a hero in the story, don't they? It's not even just that the older son is angry. It's that he boycotts the party. He's so angry. He's taking a stand on principle. isn't he? He's not going to be caught dead at a party like that, filled with people like those. Knowing what they've done, like if I show up to a celebration with those people, people might think that I approve of those people and the things that they've done, the places they've been. I'm not going to be scared by him like that. Religious elite love this guy, don't they? Like, unleash the outrage machine. But notice the older son, the son on the outside, he's boycotting the story, and he doesn't know the story. He only sees the surface and knows what he's heard. He doesn't ask how his brother is. He doesn't ask where his brother's been. He doesn't know why his brother left, or what he's experienced, or how he's been hurt, or why he came back. None of that. The older brother chooses to boycott the party because he's filled with quote unquote righteous anger without relational compassion. Righteous anger without relational compassion. I was at a lunch a couple of weeks ago for an organization in Fort Worth. It's an incredible organization we get to support and partner with as a church called The Net. And some of you are familiar with The Net. The Net works with survivors of trafficking and with women primarily who are coming out of the adult entertainment industry, some of them coming out of incarceration because of their involvement with some of that stuff. And one of the people that spoke, actually a survivor of that, made this comment. I thought it was so powerful that she was sharing her story. She said, you know, as Christ followers, we have to learn to ask different questions. Anybody can ask, how could she? We need to be ready to ask, who is she? How did she get here? That seems like an extreme example for some of us, perhaps. Those same questions apply to any number of encounters that we have every single week with people that we know, people that we see, sometimes people that we worship with, when we scroll through our feed on social media, and we find ourselves asking the easy questions. How could we? How could she? How could they think that? How could they support that? How could they believe that? How could they do that? Instead of spending our righteous anger long enough to ask the next question. Who is it? Who is she? How did they get here? Now, is there room for righteous anger? You bet there is. But was anger apart from the story? That a person apart from a relationship can be awfully careful. We'll spend our whole lives making sure we're right, ever hearing of anyone else's concern. And that kind of anger, it turns out, is not righteous anger. Because it doesn't reflect the heart of God. Our goodness and our uprightness will become the weapon we use against God's people, the people that He loves, and sometimes the weapon that we use against God Himself. In fact, that's exactly how it goes in this story. Father, here, older son's missing from the party. That fits the arc of all three stories of Luke 15, doesn't it? Sheep is lost, sheep is pursued, sheep is found, and there's a party. Coin is lost, coin is pursued, coin is found, there's a party. Younger son is lost, younger son is pursued, younger son is found, there's a party. Uh-oh, older son is lost. What's next? Son is pursued. That's exactly what happens. Look at verse 28. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. There's the pursuit. But he answered the father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you. I've never disobeyed your orders. But you never gave me even a young goat so I could go celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you killed a fat calf for him. So you had moral activity with mission apathy. You had righteous anger without relational compassion. Here, what do you have? You have competition, comparison, and entitlement. Competition, comparison, and entitlement. The older son's been keeping score this whole time, hasn't he? And again, notice something about the relationship there in verse 29. He says, I've been slaving for you, obeying your orders. That's slave language, not the way that his son talks to his father, right? He says, for years, He refuses to experience the celebration because the spotlight of the party, the blessing, is on someone who deserves it less than him. He believes it's a problem with the Father. Good sons deserve good lives. And it's only bad fathers that don't give it to them all the time. So I believe all your blessings, God, are my rights. There's something big, like marriage, fertility, or career success. And smaller slices that lodge in our soul like splinters. Competition, comparison, or keep us from a life of celebration. Is a temptation that's as old as the garden. Our focus to the one thing we haven't received, rather than the billions of things that we have. Our Father hasn't been restricted with us. Come on, we've just gotten used to his generosity. You know what he says in verse 31? My son, the Father said, you are always with me. Everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours is dead, is alive again. He's lost. He's found. What's the implication there? Come on in the party, son. Celebrate with you. To follow the storyline together. Something lost. Something pursued. Something found. There's a new friend. Three different times it happens. And now we're where in the cycle? Lost older son. Pursued older son. And the curtain drops. The story ends. Before the end of the story. But what are we missing? What are we expecting to come next? What about the son being found? What about the big celebration? Jesus tells the story in such a way that you and I get to that point in the story, he can ask you a question. About two sons. Which son represents you today? The younger, wayward son, for whom a combination of rebellion and good intentions led in some places good intentions never got you to go. Treading water in a sea of regret, desperate for some kind of rescue. You think that's a son today? Maybe it's the other son. The well behaved, moral, religious, hard-working son who stayed close to home, but discovering the long way from the child of God. Which one is true? It's a finished day. Whichever one you are, the Father is pursuing you. He wants to welcome you. He wants to forgive you and restore you and celebrate you and invite you to the party. That's where it all comes together. It's the promise and the hope for all of us. And the reason Jesus told the story is what life with the Father can be all about. The moral of the story, you will never be so lost. The Father will stop with it. You'll never be too broken. Never be too stained for the Father to make new. Never be too stuck for the Father to set free. You will never be too wounded for the Father to make you whole. You'll never be so guilty that the Father won't forgive. You'll never be so religious that you don't need redemption. You'll never be so hard to find or so that God won't. This morning you realize that it's time for you to come home. Whether it's from a place of rebellion or religion, the Father stands ready to welcome you home today. And it's as simple as right where you are, right where you sit, to tell him come in the privacy of your heart in your own words, Father, I believe that you've been pursuing me. That you're willing to welcome me back to forgive my sins, to pay off my debt. In fact, that you've done it through the death of Jesus on a cross. And that he rose from the dead and invites me in a life that's truly life, with no shame, without any of my sin attached to me. He's covered me. He's offered me access to his account. You welcome me into your love, and I'm receiving that as a gift today. No amount of believing, or moral right standing, or comparison, no amount of good enough will ever be good enough. I need a rescue. Lord, for those who are receiving your rescue today for the very first time, and some of us who are reflecting back on our rescue story, would you let us be the kind of people that never settle for less than life while we live, even while we wait to spend eternity with you? Would you let us participate in what you're doing all around us every single day? Be a part of the rescue mission so that we can be a part of your great celebration every single day as we see it happening all around us. Would you never let us, Lord, settle for indignation apart from stories of relationships? Would you let us take the next step closer, ask the next question deeper? And Lord, would you keep us from comparison and competition and entitlement as if we deserve your blessing? Would you let us live in gratitude and out of gratitude as we celebrate what you've done, even while we wait for what you haven't done yet? Would you guide us, would you empower us, would you strengthen us, would you point us in the right direction, would you give us hope? We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, thanks for watching. If something you heard resonated with you today, we would love to connect with you. Visit doxology.church/connect or leave a comment below. And if you enjoyed today's message and you want to see more, make sure you give this video a like and subscribe to our channel so you don't miss any new videos.